And maybe as a bit of background, so the big thing, obviously, internationally in South Africa, the big player, especially in America, is Oncotype DX. And unfortunately, in South Africa, the company has a very big marketing strategy. Forbes did a publication in their economics magazine as a model for how you can take something from nothing to having 99% market share without really worrying about the evidence for it. And just the whole idea that you can market something into popularity and not really care about the science behind it. So maybe just to compare Oncotype with MammaPrint, I think lots of clinicians out there, professors in oncology, people that are sitting on advisory boards, have never actually read these papers in terms of how these tests were developed, how they were taken into market. And I think it's a valuable lesson in terms of how we can easily just accept something as being the gold standard without actually looking at, why it became that way. So just in short, Oncotype is obviously a 20-gene assay. It has 5 reference genes, which has nothing to do with the scoring, and it has 16 genes. And these genes were chosen from 250 oncogenes that are known to be linked to cancer prognosis and cancer outcome. So these were not new genes, and they sort of took the top 16 of those that had the best effect, and in principle, gave each of those genes a relative score. MammaPrint, on the other hand, were taken from cancer patients that had breast cancer but never developed metastases. They basically did exome sequencing. They looked at more than 20,000 genes, and they then saw signatures coming out that differed from these patients that didn't have metastases versus those that did. And that was the original publication where they suggested these 70 genes could be used as a prognostic profile. So one of the early criticisms was that, but wait a minute, these genes are not known oncogenes and they have nothing to do. And that's exactly the point. This is a completely new modality when it came out in 92 that did not correlate with stuff that we already were already using. So things like ER and PR and HER2, we know that those are prognostic things. If you want something new, you have to look at other features that are playing a role. So, and then these were validated. And again, the issue was for me, Oncotype, they tested these 21 genes on a cohort, and then they used the same cohort to validate the study, which doesn't make sense. If you use something to develop something and you test it on that same thing, you should have a very good outcome. So I think there were some scientific issues for me. So when Marita asked me about, this new modality, back when was it, in 2006 or whatever, I said, MammaPrint has the best science behind it. Oncotype, I'm concerned that they don't have good, robust science behind it. And unfortunately, that's where marketing comes in. So, bottom line is initially, Oncotype was marketed. They used different cutoff levels, but in principle, the only thing Oncotype did was to say, we have a score from 0 to 100. And if your score is 10, it means your risk is half the patient who has a score of 20. But it's a linear risk score. It's not something that was ever designed to look at metastatic potential versus no metastatic potential. And in the beginning, they used different cutoff groups to try and sort of figure out which patients are intermediate or low or high. And they used a retrospective, the NSABP-B14 cohort, to sort of test this system on. So initially, the cutoff ranges were different from what they then later used in the TAILORx trial. And in the beginning, also, it was said, well, okay, low-risk patients don't need chemo, but intermediate and high-risk probably do. So, it was sort of something that was developed. MammaPrint was, from the start, developed as a modality as saying, you have a risk of metastatic disease and you don't. And so it has always been a binary thing. It really isn't a linear thing. There's a publication that looks at ultra-low-risk patients that might not even need endocrine therapy. And there's, I think, one publication that looked at sort of very high-risk patients. But in principle, MammaPrint has never been validated or designed as a linear type of thing. It's always been designed as a binary decision-making tool with a very small gray area in the middle if you have patients there. So obviously the big trials for the two TaylorX was the first trial. They enrolled close to 10,000 patients in that, but only 14% of those patients had a recurrence score above 26. So the majority of those 10,000 patients were either low or intermediate risk patients for which the value of chemotherapy was already a little bit of an issue. So in the end, you end up with a very small portion of patients that you want to look at. MINDACT, however, said, okay, we're going to enroll 6,500 patients. They struggled with enrollment, but now they have close to 9 years in follow-up, mean follow-up. So it has the longest follow-up of all these trials. They used a completely different approach, which caused lots of issues in terms of, yeah, is this real? And there's this 1.4% difference between the two groups and all kinds of stuff. But in principle, MINDACT has shown now, last year it was the long-term results was published and was reported at ASCO, and we can now really see that robustness of it coming out. So also, MINDACT was designed with a specific chemotherapy regimen in mind. They used TC as the chemotherapy. One can argue about that, but it was standardized in terms of every patient getting the same. Whereas in the Oncotype, in the TaylorX trial, the patients could get whatever chemotherapy the clinician wanted. And you can see there on the left-hand side of the screen that there were quite significant differences. In principle, 42% got a taxane-only regimen. About 42% got what we would consider to be the standard of care, being an anthracycline with a taxane. Whether it was dose-dense or not, we don't know, but that was the combination. Only 18% got the combination. So there were about sort of 60% of patients that got only TC or got only AC times 4, for example. So lots of differences in that. And then again, they changed the cutoff points from what they had in their previous trials, now using recurrent scores of 26 and things and 10. So changed their cutoff scores for this trial. And in principle, what are the big things that we can say about this? Okay, from TaylorX, remember, these are all node negative patients. We can say if you're older than 50 and if you have a recurrent score of under 26, then you do not benefit from chemotherapy. So node negative over 50. Now, I must say, if you are node negative over 50 with an ER positive tumor, chemo already has very little benefit for you in any case, and you would have very few patients ending up in that range. If you are, however, under 50, then even in the low risk group, there's some benefit of chemotherapy, but I would say, well, if it's under 15 or up to 15, probably not much benefit. If you fall into the 16 to 20 group, then you have a low to medium risk, but you have to sort of start talking to the patient and weighing up the different benefits. And again, remember, we're talking node negative patients. And if you have a recurrence score between 20 and 21, you have a medium risk of recurrence, and there might be some benefit to chemo. So again, now, actually, menopausal status almost becomes a really big issue in this. On MammaPrint, they initially just looked at clinically high-risk patients who had a low genomic signature on MammaPrint, and in principle, the 5-year disease in metastatic free survival was 95.1%. They said if it were the accepted amount would be 92, and if we are above that, then we have met the non-inferiority boundary, which they then could prove. Ponder X came along and they said, well, let's enroll some patients with node positive disease. And they basically just looked at patients with a recurrence score under 25, accepting that everybody with 26 and up should really have chemotherapy. And they then randomized the patients with endocrine versus endocrine plus chemotherapy. Again, not prescribing the chemo, but you know, oncologists could give whatever they wanted. And they stratified the patient. And they looked at, you know, now they looked at menopausal status, and they looked at the node, you know, whether it's node positive versus just sentinel node positive, to try and just make sure if there's some, you know, some issues in terms of age. MammaPrint also did a post hoc analysis of their data in the MINDACT trial to look at, remember, MINDACT enrolled ER positives, but also HER2 positives, and they also enrolled some ERPR negative patients. So it wasn't limited to ERPR positive patients only. So if we looked at, you know, same group, Ponder X and Taylor X, looking at ERPR and HER2 negative only, so if you compare apples to apples, and we try and sort of look at the same cohort of patients, we saw that at 8 years, the distant and metastasis-free survival, if you omitted chemotherapy for women over 50 in that group, 90.2 versus 90.0%. So no difference in survival at 8 years, 8.7 years for postmenopausal women. So again, confirming the MammaPrint assay as a robust predictor of lack of benefit. There was an issue that in patients under the age of 50, you can see 93.6 versus 88.6, that's a 5% absolute benefit difference for chemotherapy in premenopausal women. You know, you can see it was only 460 patients, so a very underpowered. All right. So in principle, the final analysis in Oncotype, we say patients who have, there's no survival benefit in chemo if you have a recurrent score under 26 in postmenopausal women. If you are, there's a 5.2% absolute benefit at 5 years in premenopausal women. And if we're looking at, if we're just looking at nodal status and stuff like that, in principle, we are concerned that in the premenopausal group of patients, there's some significant concern or about, you know, omitting chemotherapy in patients with lower recurrent scores. So one should just bear that in mind. In MammaPrint, we now have a similar concern to say in the premenopausal patients, we just need to be a little bit more careful. But in terms of nodal status, so the thing is, if you look at Taylor X versus Ponder X, node negative versus node positive, nodal status retains an important risk in patients that are on the Oncotype data. In MammaPrint, nodal status made no difference. So menopausal status, yes. Nodal status, no. So I think one from the introduction or from our reading and everything, I think what one just has to take into account is if you have a premenopausal patient that is a MammaPrint low risk, one just has to discuss that thing of saying, well, there is a 5% benefit. And so if you have, you know, three nodes, if you have a grade three, if you have a fairly big tumor, so, you know, as your clinical risks start escalating, one might want to consider in a premenopausal patient whether that patient shouldn't maybe just get chemotherapy. So I would be a little bit more careful about premenopausal patients and doing MammaPrints routinely on them.